Hey everyone, welcome
Hey!
back to our channel.
What's up?
So in this video, we're gonna talk about the movie that James was just recently on, The Bee Who Stole Christmas.
Yes! I finally can talk about it. Oh my God, it's finally out. It took, well, not that long, it was like months, but still, it took a minute for us.
It felt like a long time.
It felt longer.
And if you have never seen me without facial hair, here you go. Oh my God, I hate how I look without facial hair.
You look so young.
No, it looks so, I miss my facial hair. I accidentally shaved on accident.
Well, it was a process of trial and error because we gave each other fades. So yours on me came out a lot better the first time than mine's on you.
We try to give each other fades. All right, but anyways, let's move on. I wouldn't say this is a review. It's more like a discussion.
Yeah.
I feel like, honestly, this movie was the campiest Christmas movie I've seen.
I will go out on record and say it is the campiest movie of all time.
Of all time. So the movie starts off with
Krista, who's playing Maggie. Well, now she turns herself into Maggie. Olivia. Her name is Olivia.
Olivia.
She wasn't called Olivia for like a long time in the movie. But yeah, she is a well-to-do, always busy fashion journalist who is put on the assignment by RuPaul in a green screened room.
And the magazine is called Gorge.
Gorge, yep.
And it starts off, I believe, sorry, this is as we remember, we saw it like a few days ago. But yeah.
It's even sadder because we've watched it like 5 times, but we kind of fast forward to my parts for the most part. Well, why wouldn't we?
Oh my God, not telling on us.
I'll tell on myself, I don't care. But yeah, I mean, Olivia plays, you know, a super busy, has no time for play fashion journalist, and she gets put out an assignment to find a crown, a winter crown.
You're skipping too far, okay?
That's the whole beginning.
I know, but I was going to talk about how it starts off with Got Meek and her having a nice little conversation. And actually, Got Meek, they're really good. Like, yeah. I was like, the acting, I was like, okay. I also didn't see Got Meek season like that. So I'm like, I didn't know Got Meek had them acting chops.
Well, I'm going to call you out right now. The reason you didn't see her season like that is because the way you watch Drag Race is you fast forward through all of it and just go right to the lip sync.
I do. That is how
and
I
the
watch.
Runway.
That is how I watch Drag Race. I'm like, let me skip to the runway and the lip sync.
So yeah, easy to see why you didn't see much of her.
Mm-hmm. But that scene was cute. It was good. And then that's when RuPaul calls in Olivia and was like, you need to get me this crown, girl.
I was there for when they filmed those scenes, though. Like, I watched it because I did pick up for that. But, like, it's all green screen. But you really
you could
really
tell. You could tell.
I mean, I suspended disbelief. Yeah. Okay.
You're, like, trying to tell me, like, you couldn't tell. It's all green screen. Like, James, you could tell.
I mean, it's strange because, like, the office with Gottmik wasn't green screen. That was a real office.
I don't know. That didn't look green screen. But when RuPaul walked in, you see the face filter and then the hair being choppy.
Yeah.
And then little green. You know, I edit. I green screen edit. I don't know how it looks when it's
you caught where the key didn't quite go. Yeah.
But yeah, who cares? It was still campy and it was still fun.
It was only like 2 minutes of your life.
Yeah,
it's fine.
And I enjoyed the whole movie. And then it goes into her going into the town of Tuckahoe.
The most Christmassy town in the world.
In the world. And honestly, it was. And then it goes into this whole singing montage. It was cute.
We had a musical number with like 15 Drag Race Girl cameos.
And who knew Raven could hit those notes?
Honestly. Or Morgan at the very end. I never knew.
Or you. When did you get high notes? And when did you sound so feminine?
Anyways, the musical number ends. The mayor does a backflip a la Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory, which you were like, what the?
I know. I was like, when she did the backflip, I'm like, what the hell?
You were so taken aback by it. Yeah, and after she does the backflip, I come on screen in a beautiful pink dress. You couldn't really tell on TV. It looked white, but it was baby, baby, baby pink.
No, it looked baby pink.
Oh, okay. Good.
Yeah, it looked good, baby pink, and then James has the crown. I was like, oh, okay. So that's how James looks with a crown on. They
asked me. What was that? They made me do like some really crazy thing with that crown. They asked me to like put a dent in my hair for a bit. Mm-hmm. And people said they could see it. I couldn't see it.
I saw it. It was like, I don't know, you need to wear glasses.
Maybe. Guys. I have terrible eyesight. That's probably the case.
But no, it started off pretty cute. They take the crown away from Dilia, which is James. She did not want to let it go. And then out of nowhere, demon voice comes out.
That demon filter to my voice. I wasn't expecting that, but it was a good touch. I have to say, like, a real MVP of this movie was Ginger.
Yeah, Ginger, well, Ginger can act. Ginger has been in so many productions.
You called it out, like, people were kind of, like, snubbing her a little bit when it came to praise, because, like, I guess she's so exposed in acting that people, like, kind of expect that out of her, but, like, she carried good. A lot of this movie.
Yeah, she was good. Who else? Okay, so the cast was...
The broads were, yeah, Kirsten Rodriguez,
Jan, Ginger Minj, Brooklyn Heights, and Peppermint. And honestly, they all... They're pretty good. Peppermint had a good beginning joke at the scene.
Yeah, she had some great little jokes in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And for a part that was really kind of not that big.
Yeah, I mean, she had to share the screen with four other drag queens and a magazine.
And they all got the ad-lib off of each other, which was good. So I was really happy about that.
And then another scene that I really enjoyed on this movie was your scene when it just starts off, when they introduce you and your whole crew.
Oh, the Kid in
Heels Court. It was really cute. You know, it reminded me, your character in that scene reminded me of the evil teacher from Harry Potter, the conservative one, the one that squeaks still.
I thought she was very much kind of like the mean, like the antagonist and bad teacher, the good teacher that Cameron Diaz is fighting with.
Oh, no. It's more like the Harry Potter evil conservative teacher, the one that makes them write.
Oh, Umbridge, and it writes on their arm. Yeah.
Is that her name?
Yeah.
Umbridge, yep, that's who your character reminded me of.
A little bit of that. I mean, I told them, like, give me lots of pastel costumes. So, I mean, that was in the back of my mind. A lot of different villainesses, from her to Montana Moorhead from Soap Dish, a lot of people.
Yeah, and then your husband, your rich husband, is Porkchop, actually.
Out of drag as a man.
I did not catch that at first. Like, I had to catch it the second time I watched the movie. I was like...
When I saw Porkchop in that makeup, I howled.
I was like, is that Porkchop?
And poor Porkchop got put through the ringer in this movie. They did so much to him. It felt so bad.
And honestly, there was an article where Porkchop said that you were just in there where you act the house down. And I was just like, I wasn't surprised about the character that James was portraying on screen. Because honestly, I've seen it because I was here where James was practicing it. So I knew what to expect. But I did not know that so many people were going to be taken aback of how you acted. Then I was like, whoa, okay, because I've seen it, and everybody was just giving compliments and positive reviews, which is what you want in a movie. You want those critiques. So it was pretty good job, Jane.
Thank you. I mean, I worked really hard, and I like mentioned it in my own video that, like, had you not drilled into me that I had to practice, it would not have been.
Oh, my God. It's like
I was the most prepared there.
Every day I was like, James, have you read your lines? And it's like, yeah, I have. I'm like, all right, then what is this line? And James is like, I'm like, do that in practice.
I was such a
brat. Better read those lines.
I was such a brat about it.
Or like every now and then I'd be grabbing the script and I'm like, okay, James, what goes after this? Now read the line before. And then James is like, I'm like, you gotta read them again.
Oh, yeah, this was filmed on the Disney branch, and like the like house I had was actually a house that they told me was used for Desperate Housewives. Oh. I don't know which one. I think it might have been Breeze. It's one of those really big, broad houses.
You said one of the sets was from WandaVision, right?
Yeah, the town square is from WandaVision.
Yeah, I'm like, ooh, I do remember that was where the fight scene happened.
And it's not giving any tea, because like that set's been used a lot in music videos and all sorts of TV shows.
And it looked good. There was like a pretty high budget in this movie. Like, I mean, obviously it had its green screen moments, but even that, I felt like that was like campy.
Well, it's a parody too. Like, that's the other thing. Like, I feel like a lot of people are approaching this thing, it's like a very serious movie. Like, it has serious moments, but at the core, it's a parody.
This is a made-for-TV movie. To me, it reminded me like of Hallmark Lifetime movies, but with a little better acting and funnier.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, a lot of spoofs, like, you have to like the material in order to like really make fun of it. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's where it kind of walked that fine line where it wasn't making too much of like a rancid joke about it. Because the people that wrote this really love those movies.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Are they? Well, I didn't, you know, I don't read credits.
It's like, I talked to the writers and they were just like, yeah, we love Hallmark and Lifetime. And these Christmas movies that are so cheesy. We want to make a gay one.
And jobs on, because that's what it reminded me of, the Hallmark, the Lifetime movies. It was fun. It was funny. I really enjoyed the movie.
Some memorable moments that like blew me out of the water, because like I heard rumblings that it was going to happen, that Kim Petras was in the movie.
Oh, yeah, that was pretty good. And especially since right now in this time, I feel like Kim Petras is making her mainstream come up.
Oh, yeah.
So I feel like a movie like this will also boost her getting a fan base for the people that haven't heard of her yet.
It's weird watching it happen because, like, when we filmed this, this is before she performed at the VMAs. So, like, she was still kind of, like, bubbling under, and then she performed at the VMAs.
And then the EMAs, and that's when everybody got obsessed with coconuts.
Yep.
Oh, a memorable moment for me is, like, it's more towards the end of the movie. For me, a memorable was Latrice Royale.
Yes.
Latrice was so funny in this. Like, oh, my God. Like, I don't want to spoil the movie to the people who haven't watched it.
Her part is pretty epic.
Mm-hmm.
I was laughing at that
It
so
was
much.
Pretty funny. The movie's not for everyone. Obviously, some people are not going to like it. But if you have a sense of humor and you just like I said, those Lifetime movies, Hallmark movies, but like funnier and campier and LGBTQIA plus friendly, then this is a movie for you.
The way I've been describing it to people is like, it's like if John Waters made a made-for-TV Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm. I don't know why John Waters doesn't make movies anymore.
He can't get the budget he wants.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Nobody wants to give him the money.
I mean, I honestly, this is going to be like a spoiler for our channel, but James and I have been talking about just making our own little skits on YouTube because we are fans of like people like Stevie TV, Rest in Peace. She was funny. I enjoyed those kind of videos and I kind of want to make some over here. Just make some funny little skits just for the YouTube channel just to have fun because I don't know, I find that fun. So I'm like, spoiler, that might happen. Another memorable moment for me was the scene with you and that actor that's in all those Will Ferrell movies. Sorry, I'm bad with names. But you know who I'm talking about.
I know exactly what you're talking about, yeah.
To me, that was a memorable scene because James literally looked like Jaymes Mansfield in there. So I was just like, okay. Because you even got a bottle from World of Wonder saying, thank you, Jaymes Mansfield. Like, that was a cheeky moment.
I thought I told you don't bring that up. I swear they know my name over there.
instead of Jaymes Mansfield, they put Jaymes Mansfield. We had our heterosexual friend here watching the movie with us, and he jumped when he saw him.
He popped off.
He was so happy to see him. So, yeah, he has his own audience. So that moment was memorable because you look really good, and then the acting obviously was good, and then both of you had this little storyline going on. So that's a memorable moment for me.
Another memorable moment for me was I got to do dance numbers in this.
Oh my God. No, James can't dance.
I can't dance at all. But I can say this and say it in all earnestness. I have been choreographed by Travis Wall.
Oh my God. Not gonna lie, that, I mean, it was really bad, that scene with James dancing, but it was also funny because they were supposed to be bad.
We were supposed to be bad.
They're housewives. And none of them are like trained dancers, even though I saw Morgan McMichael's killing it with spinning the arms around.
Well, she's an arm performer anyway. She's teaching me all her little arm moves. And like, he choreographed that in literally 5 minutes.
I mean, it's still,
he had to do it so fast.
It's still, they would have had to do it because at the end of the day, you're the villain. You're not supposed to be great.
Yeah. And what I loved about it, too, is, like, we had extras in that who were all my Kitten Heel Court girls. It was me and Morgan and a bunch of other girls who were extras for it that had no speaking lines. And they were so happy just being so much of the movie.
I would be happy, too. Like, I'm like, I don't have to speak and I'm going to be in all so much of the movie. Like,
so much of the movie, close-ups and everything is great. They were so thrilled.
I mean, I would have been thrilled, too. And honestly, not going to lie, this movie is going to be, like, a staple in the drag community. You know how, like, Pink Flamingos is a staple? This movie is camp enough to be a staple as well, like a cult classic.
Yeah, there's no other Christmas movie like this.
Mm-hmm.
Like nothing that's Christmas centered. Like as far as like, there's been some gay Netflix movies and whatnot. Watch a couple of them already where not gay enough.
But not with like drag queens.
Drag queens playing like actual acting roles. Mm-hmm. They're not just casted as drag queens.
Because there's like, it's like not, it's just like there's, the cast is so diverse. There's PLC, there's drag queens, there's trans women, there's trans men. It's just like, where have you seen a movie like this?
I like it too, is like, it's very much like John Waters movies in like the 70s where like drag queens aren't playing drag queens. They're just playing characters.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that's none of that matters.
And that's the camp of it all.
Yeah.
We would review the whole movie, but honestly, you should watch it.
They aren't playing it enough. Y'all should catch the reruns, all right? Watch it,
so
enjoy it.
As of now, you could catch it on VH1. You could do the VH1.com. Honestly, I've seen some people say that they're trying to free trial at VH1.com. And that's how they're seeing it.
Philo.
We have Philo. That's how we watch it. I just hit save and I can just watch it over and over again. I know it's in Hulu if you have the live TV stream. There's another streaming app that it has, but so far it's VH1 app, VH1.com. Get that free pass. VH1, the network, Philo, and there's another one, Hulu live stream. And I believe it may be put up for sale before Christmas, Yeah, but possibly. As of now, those are the ways you could view it.
So honestly, if you want to see this movie, make a point to go out and see it. Or not go out, but stay in and see it.
Oh my God, we're going to go see it.
You don't have to go out to see it. Make a point to stay in and see it. You know, DVR, do whatever you got to do. But watch it, because if it does well, they're going to make more.
It's a campy movie. If you're into camp, this is the movie for you.
And if you're into me, it's the perfect movie for you.
Now, we are a little biased. Because obviously James is in it.
For me, it's like to go to an old joke, like from Married with Children. The husband always talked about how he ran like 4 touchdowns in 1 football game. This is the story I always tell at cocktail parties now. Okay, did you know that I was in a movie?
You could say that too now.
I could say it now.
Did you know that I was in a movie?
I was a star of a movie. Yeah. My colleague's RuPaul.
No, and now your colleague, Baby Jesus.
Yes.
Baby Jesus is James' colleague.
Oh my God, Baby Jesus. Which, I'll give you a little insight. I dropped that doll.
Oh my God.
I almost broke it. I dropped the Baby Jesus.
Thanks for watching this video. If you watched the movie, let us know what your favorite moment of the movie was down below in the comment section. You already heard our favorite moments. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And deuces!
Deuces! Bye, y'all! Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas, and a Happy New Year, and Happy Holidays, whatever you celebrate.
Yes!